Welcome back to the show. Now, last week, Uganda expressed concern over segregation by the International Coffee Organization and went ahead to pause her membership for 2 years until these challenges have been sorted out. But is there a better way that we could get money from coffee within Uganda alone? On how to make the money this week, we explore the farmer ownership model by Inukafe that focuses on value addition and has seen their profits multiply, plus many farmers getting big profit from their coffee.
Let's start with how Inukafe works with farmers and what your goal is.
Very good. First of all, my name is Joseph Nkando. I'm the executive director of Inukafe. Inukafe is the National Association of Coffee Farmers. It is a membership organization owned and run by farmers themselves. As a membership organization, to date, we have over 1.5 million smallholder coffee farmers that are part of Inukafe, and they are organized within the communities where they produce coffee in over 200 associations and cooperatives. Inukafe runs on the farmer ownership model. What this means is that farmers take ownership by taking responsibility as masters of their own destiny. It means that farmers don't wait for somebody to come and say, "Oh, I'm giving you this." Not at all. You know, from within the farmers, we say we need to be self-sustaining. And this is a pain that we have to go through for the current but also future generations. The problem we are working on is that for a long time, coffee farmers have been earning less than 5% of their retail value. And this is the most important thing that we are working on as Inukafe, to ensure that we break the intergenerational poverty that has been characterized with the farmers from generation to generation. And not any other model that can do that. It is the farmer ownership model. But we know how hard it is for us to ensure that the farmer ownership model becomes the normal business model for not only the coffee value chain, but also other agricultural value chain. So what happens with the farmer ownership model? As farmers produce their coffee, Inukafe is at their disposal to empower them, to train them, to pass on the necessary skills for them to produce the quality of coffee that is needed by the consumer. So the farmer must be able to speak the language that the consumer understands. And therefore, Inukafe is there to ensure that it passes on what kind of attributes that the consumer is looking for in the coffee. So the handling practices, the good agricultural practices, the climate smart solutions that are needed at the farm level are key for Inukafe to carry on with all its members. Now, after the farmers produce the coffee has to be brought to the various processing centers of Inukafe. And therefore, when it arrives there, that's when Inukafe is supposed to make a part payment. It can be 50%, it can be 60%, depending on the availability of capital. This is where it is always so challenging, for us to make sure that we have the available, capital. So the farm ownership model calls for value addition. And value addition, it means you have to take a bit of time for you to be able to add value to the farmer's coffee. And this is where a part payment becomes important, such that farmers can wait when New Cafe is adding value to their coffee. So these investments are a key component of adding value to farmers' coffee. The 7-in-1 factories that we have at a one-stop center here in Namanve are very, very important in the transformation that we are looking for in Uganda's coffee industry.
I understand Uganda, or even New Cafe, you are not the people who determine prices. There is a global coffee body which Uganda is currently having trouble with due to discrimination. So how then do you confirm to the farmers that they will have a say in how much we buy the coffee for?
Yeah, I think everyone is aware that coffee marketing was liberalized, and therefore it is the market forces that determine, you know, prices. So as producers, what we embarked on, and especially Uganda, is to produce the quality, maximum quality of coffee, high quality of coffee. And we are involved in the production of specialty coffee, which is of highest quality. And therefore, we are selling quality. So it is that quality that we use to determine, you know, the price of coffee. Nobody will tell you that there is this body that determines the price of coffee. Not even the International Coffee Organization. International Coffee Organization is simply a coordinator, an organization that gathers statistics to do with the coffee from all over the world, from all over its members. Okay, so that's what ICO, the International Coffee Organization, is doing. It does not regulate prices, not at all. It is the market forces that do that. So the sellers and buyers meet and determine, you know, the prices. Of course, we must be aware that there is a lot of speculation that goes on in the marketplace. And this is the evil that has been characterized with the coffee value chain for ages. And that we must work hard as producer organizations to ensure that even within our own countries, we create a domestic market, such that the market is near with us, and that we can, you know, play around with the prices, and that we know nobody will come to say that this is how we are going to increase the prices. We are very much aware that consumption and the demand of coffee is much higher than what is produced. But because of speculation, they tend to play around with the prices such that they can go down. But even with that, we have seen in the recent past, especially in this year 2022, how prices, you know, have come up. Prices are supposed to be up, okay? But prices of raw commodities will never always, you know, be stable. So eventually what we have to struggle for is to ensure that we manufacture what we produce into a finished product. But of course, we must know the global political economy of coffee.
So of what importance was the International Coffee Organization to Uganda's visibility, and how will this affect Uganda in that we are taking a 2 years break from that, from the organization?
Yeah, of course, the importance is that it is always important to be in a club, okay? and you try to come up with issues whereby the club members can agree upon, okay? But the point we are making is that there are issues that producer countries of coffee have always come up with to ensure that, you know, members of International Coffee Organization can agree upon. Let me, you know, look at what is the membership of the International Coffee Organization. First of all, the International Coffee Organization is an intergovernmental organization. Okay? Its membership is of producing and importing countries. Okay? And by governments. So it is member countries. Meaning that at the round table of International Coffee Organization, you have importing countries, you have exporting countries or producer countries. So you are not alone. Okay? Now at that table you are discussing the point Uganda is fronting and other producer countries, not alone as Uganda, is that there is a lot that needs to be done at that round table of ICO. To listen to coffee producing countries, they would wish to add more value to coffee and export it as a finished product. Okay? But in importing countries, what is happening? There are stringent conditions on a finished product in terms of food safety. These food safety requirements are that stringent that for one to penetrate a market is not easy, okay? And who owns these stringent conditionalities? It is the importing countries. And you must be aware that these food safety requirements are very subjective, okay? So where we are coming from, we are coming from a point of high tariffs on value-added products. But point came and say, okay, now it is free entry into the market. But the main issue now is to do with food safety requirements. And these are difficult, you know, to meet. And they are costly even because you have to meet certain, you know, standards. So these are all conditionalities that prevent coffee producing countries from adding value and export, you know, a finished product into the developed world. So these are issues that are pertinent and that ICO agreements need to put into consideration. So the point is the International Coffee Agreement 2007 expired, and then they called for an extension. But you are extending within an agreement that is not catering for your needs that are transformative. Okay? So we should do appreciate the fact that these needs have to be taken into account. And we should appreciate the fact that if you are a member of a certain body and it is not catering for your needs, why should you stay? And it has expired. And by the way, is it Uganda that has first declared itself? No. Even the mighty United States of America has been pulling out and coming back, pulling out and coming back.
I understand, and that for sure leaves us to go back and focus in our own countries. For like the 2 years Uganda is out, we shall need to do more work here. So talk to me about the farm ownership model.
Okay.
How relevant is this in trying to help us sell more coffee and encourage our own people to consume?
Yeah, what we came to appreciate is that at the farmer level, at the industry level, subsector level, at the country level, largely speaking, we have to take ownership. And when we talk about the farmer ownership model, it means we have taken ourselves to the farmer level. For the farmer to take ownership by taking responsibility for own transformation. Look here, if the farmer has been selling coffee on trees and no life has changed, okay? And we know very well doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different result, that is insanity, okay? Therefore, we cannot continue. So the farmer ownership model is saying, please, coffee farmer, it is time to transform from doing what you have been doing before, such that you can do things differently. So now the farmer, instead of selling coffee on trees as red cherries, instead of selling coffee as dry cherries, instead of selling coffee as parchment, it is high time you farmer, you sold coffee as first and foremost graded coffee. That alone enhances your income. You enhance your income by 250%. That one alone. Basic, you know, kind of, you know, processing, what they call agro-processing. You are not yet into manufacturing, but agro-processing. Now, for some time, farmers to spend time there. You know, that makes a big jump. Now, after some time, the farm ownership model says, then move to another level. That is transformative. You are doing things differently. That is what the farm ownership model is all about. The farm ownership model is saying we need to have policies that offers our, you know, own transformation to ensure sustainability. The farm ownership model is speaking to different sustainable development goals. It speaks to poverty eradication. You can see the jump that comes a long way in terms of income to the farmers, but also to the country, to our communities. You can see when the farmers take responsibility to make investments in, you know, infrastructure required for processing coffee. Okay? That is another sustainable development goal. Investing in renewable energy. Our factory during daytime runs on solar. So we are speaking to sustainable development goals number 7 and sustainable development goal number 13. So we are mindful of climate change and what it brings, what it impacts, you know, on our, you know, environment. Okay? So we are mindful of how women are critical in sustaining the value chain and therefore enhancing gender equity in all that we do is of paramount importance, and all that is part of our farmer ownership model.
So okay. I've seen a lot of women involved in the whole value chain here.
Yeah.
Is that something purposeful you're doing at New Cafe to have women as staff?
Yes, it is deliberate that we have women involved in the entire coffee value chain. For young, you know, women in the coffee value chain, it is very, very important. And each woman that you see at the New Cafe factory is representing not less than 6 people at home. So there is a huge multiplier effect why women are part and parcel of what New Cafe is doing.
All right, you mentioned earlier that about 5% of Ugandans are consuming coffee currently, and they were less in the past.
Yeah.
So would you attribute this to the farmer ownership model? Talk about its effect on consumption by Ugandans.
Yeah, the why we see coffee consumption is increasing, there are a number of factors. One, We have invested, the country is investing in improving the necessary skills along the entire coffee value chain. And individual players really are doing this because there are different skill sets that are required at different nodes of the coffee value chain. Never before did we have the barista skills that are required towards the end of the value chain. When you are in a cafe and you want to produce a good cup of coffee, it is not every Tom and Dick that is in position to do so. You need a barista, you know, who understands the language of a consumer. Now, these kind of skills, you don't find them in our universities and colleges, not at all. And therefore, these are of recent past. So Ugandans would not be interested in taking coffee because a cup of coffee that would be prepared in the last 20, 30 years would not be a best cup of coffee. Two, the purchasing power that is, you know, enhancing from time to time. You know, the middle class is emerging and therefore people have disposable income to grab a cup of coffee in a cafe. You know, 20 years ago we only had one coffee shop in Kampala as a city. Today we have more than 200 of them. So this tells you how, you know, the transformation is taking place. And of course, you know, the training places that are coming into place, you know, at New Cafe, you've seen, you know, our quality laboratory and where we train. We host on average, you know, 70 interns from the various colleges and universities, and people coming from also, you know, other places, non-school going, young people, you know, come around to learn. And also some academies are merging, you know, from all over the place. And these are some of the factors that are merging. And of course, we've seen also transformation in the policy. Our past policies focused more on coffee primary agricultural production. Today, when you look at the national coffee policy, which New Cafe advocated for a long time and engaged the government, it tackles the entire coffee value chain. When you look at the recent National Coffee Act 2021, it looks at the entire coffee value chain. So all these factors coming together, you know, are influencing also increasing domestic coffee consumption. And it is a good development. It is a good development looking at where we are coming from.
Indeed, there is always markets if we could just add value to our products and try selling them back at home before we can try to export them. On Personal Finance Tonight, the Chief Financial Officer Vision Group, Augustine Tamale, shares ideas on investment post-COVID-19.
Hello, Augustine Tamale are my names, and I'd like to share with you a few tips about personal finances. I know we are coming back from the lockdown. The economy is opening up and there are key issues that need to be addressed in our personal finances. Of course, right now it may not be the appropriate time to talk about the passive income, how to get it in. But then as the economy opens up and you're starting to make a few coins here and there, bear in mind that during the lockdown, what was important was for someone to have passive income. When we were advised to stay home, everybody who had capacity to earn, capacity to access food, that's the person that didn't have a lot of trouble during the lockdown. So it's important for everybody to have passive income. Each one of us, as we work in this opened up economy, we should set aside some money to invest in passive income. I know some of you had invested in businesses. Businesses are good. They are good, but during a lockdown, businesses are locked down. And some businesses can only operate when you yourself are present. So in a lockdown, the business ceases. Some businesses were considered non-essential, yet they were important to you as an individual. So it's the passive income that kept people moving. The first passive income that we had was for government securities. Everybody who participates in buying treasury bills, treasury bonds, had income even during the lockdown. So it's important that you consider to invest in government securities. That income remains. By the way, even into retirement, if you are employed and you've bought a 20-year or 40-year bond, you keep earning that money even into your retirement. And then at maturity, you get even the entire investment that you did put in, having enjoyed the interest coupon rates that were coming through twice a year. So investing in government securities is very important. You need to make use of the literature on government securities. It's there in our newspapers weekly. Read through and understand where you have a problem. Consult so that you get to know what's the minimum investment. How can I get into it? Probably you can't invest in it alone and you need a team of people to come together and you put in, say, 50 million or 100 million for that investment. But it's very important. It helped people a lot during the lockdown when people went to half salaries or no business revenue. At least there was some income that was coming through. So government securities are very, very important as passive income. There are other securities as well, which we'll explore another time, because there are several securities. You have unit trusts from the insurance companies. You've got the fixed deposit. Nowadays, the interest rates of fixed deposits have a bit tumbled. We have several other instruments that you can get into to help you out. And when you get a good insurance company, they can relay it to you. But we shall inform you bit by bit so that you know the various securities that you can invest in. But there was another passive investment, for passive income investment that you could undertake. Well, that was rentals. Unfortunately, during the lockdown, the tenants didn't have money, so they were not paying. Tenants were not paying. Some even asked for discounts. Now, it meant that your income is distorted. In that case, having only one source of passive income is risky. This pandemic and its lockdown opened up our eyes to several issues. Personally, I thought that someone having rentals made a lot of sense, even if you have only rentals. Because as a child, I studied on rentals. My father died when I was in primary two. But all through, my mother, who was a housewife, only collected rent and was able to educate me. And I completed university. So I knew that rentals are very important. So that's the philosophy also I had in my head. But the pandemic opened up my eyes that rentals are not the only thing. When the tenants came for discounts, even asking for delayed payments. Up now we have tenants who haven't paid up. They're still servicing arrears of last year. They're still trying to clear. So it's now a true matter that you cannot only have one source of passive income. You need a mixture in order to sail through troubled waters like those that came through this economic lockdown. At the moment, I may appear to be addressing the wrong individual who is just coming back from a half pay or no pay, talking about passive income. No, I'm addressing the correct person. As your income is returning, your salary is getting back to normal, or you are getting back a job if you had lost one, or your business is opening up, customers are starting to buy, this is the moment for you to consider saving so that you can invest in passive income. Don't consume all that you are earning.
because I cannot guarantee what is the next economic instability coming through. When it comes, it should find when you have already moved ahead on your plan. So consumption of more than 50% of your earnings is highly risky. You need to understand that your consumption on day-to-day issues, clothes, food, utilities, and so on, should not exceed 50% of your earnings. The other money should help you in investment. Save at least 20%. Then I expect that the other 20 goes on any development expenditure that you have immediately. Of course, the other 10, I expect if you are spiritual, you will use it in your house of worship. If you are not, at least do some charity. If you're not, but I would advise you to be spiritual. But well, if you are not, in the meantime, use it for charity to help. Maybe you are in a Rotary or some other thing. Do something good for humanity. But that is now the other 50. 20% should be saved. 20% the immediate investments you have, probably to improve on your business. Then 10 for charity or your spiritual activities. Consumption should never ever exceed 50. When you exceed 50, if you're a salary earner, if your net pay is 800,000, fit your expenditure in the 400,000. Beyond 400,000, you are eating your future and you are planning for trouble whenever there is any instability. So I hope that you've taken note of that and it will be a good blessing for you.
As you work and save, it's always a good idea to know where to invest your money so that you don't make losses and regret why you were saving in the first place. Let's take a look at the Forex and Money Market Report. That's it for this week on The Business Show, and from the team and I, thank you. We appreciate the time you spent watching the show. As a business person, always look out for opportunities in the market. For example, Valentine's Day, which was Monday, but make sure to watch the market and not create wastage in your supply. There was a lot of supply for red flowers and some were wasted because the market could not consume everything. So it's always important to watch out and see what you can give and rather have a shortage than have excess. Thank you very much. Good night.